Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Marie Goujon, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland's seas are wonderfully rich and diverse, and that's reflected in the abundance of wildlife that we see and the benefits that we all enjoy, whether that's through the delicious, healthy seafood that we eat, the jobs that are supported, or the coastal communities which reap the benefits from having this fantastic natural asset on their doorsteps. Now, with such diversity and abundance comes great responsibility. And the sheer breadth of human activity at sea inevitably brings impacts for the marine environment. It's therefore incumbent on us all to understand, to manage, mitigate and reduce those impacts in order to secure our natural resources for generations to come. A key part of this is ensuring that fishing activity within Scottish waters is operating sustainably and responsibly. This commitment to sustainable fisheries management is locked into our overarching fisheries management strategy, and it will drive many of the new policies and management improvements planned over the period to 2030. But it is also important to acknowledge the socio-economic importance of fishing, and the last year has not been easy for many in the fishing industry. We've seen significant ongoing economic challenges caused by the COVID-19 pandemic, and many businesses and individuals are continuing to feel the devastating impacts from the UK's exit from the European Union, and they will continue to do so. I'm proud that the Scottish Government has been able to support the fishing industry during this period through the provision of hardship funding and support towards a more resilient and safe future, for example, with targeted funding for the NEFROP sector, investment in safety improvements and training, and helping young fishers to enter the sector. Now, this support must go further still, as we work with the fishing industry and the wider fisheries stakeholder community, and that includes other UK fisheries administrations and international partners, to adapt to the changing strategic and operating environment and to deliver a just transition towards a more sustainable future. The signing of the Bute House Agreement in August last year means that the spotlight is now, more than ever, on the twin crises of climate change and biodiversity loss, which requires urgent action in order to deliver change on a significant and long-lasting scale. Now, in our current programme for government, we've committed to publishing our approach to the blue economy through an action plan. Now, this recognises the importance of Scotland's marine space and marine sectors as national assets that are critical to meeting our ambitions for sustainable stewardship of the marine environment. The action plan will be underpinned by a vision and will provide a framing and ambition for Scotland's marine management policies, strategies and plans, including the fisheries management strategy. Our vision for Scotland's blue economy is clear, that the actions required to sustainably steward our marine environment cannot be delivered in isolation. We have a strong tradition of co-management within Scotland, working with our fisheries stakeholders to respond to topical and difficult issues. By working in partnership through our co-management groups, I am confident that we can deliver the best outcomes for Scotland's marine environment, our seafood sector and coastal communities. The 12 actions underpinning our fisheries management strategy are important building blocks to deliver these outcomes. Our initial actions will be prioritised around the environment, recognising the scale of the change needed and to help tackle some of our most difficult fisheries management challenges. Today sees significant progress on two key actions. Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to announce that we are publishing Scotland's draft future catching policy this afternoon. The introduction of the landing obligation as part of the Common Fisheries Policy aimed to tackle the widespread, damaging and unacceptable issue of discarding across the EU. Scotland played a key role in shaping this discard ban whilst part of the EU, and we remain fully committed to the principles underpinning the current regulations. However, we and our stakeholders, including fishing and environmental groups, acknowledge that there have been issues with implementation and the policy is not as effective as it could be. The future catching policy seeks to change this. By proposing a different approach, working closely with stakeholders, we will ensure the right management measures are in place to support pragmatic decision-making. The consultation will test a number of the main components in the future catching policy. Firstly, working in partnership with fishers, scientists and environmental groups, we aim to put in place additional technical and spatial management measures to reduce catches of unwanted fish. This might include increased net selectivity or spawning stock area closures. Secondly, we will help the fishing industry avoid bycatch of sensitive marine species such as seabirds, seals and cetaceans. No fisher wants to catch these species, and we must work together to preserve them in the wider ecosystem. Thirdly, we will take a pragmatic approach by considering different fleet segments, avoiding the one-size-fits-all approach, which we know doesn't work in mixed fisheries with varied management issues. Fourthly, we intend to adjust current rules around discarding to simplify where required and ensure that rules can be and are complied with. And finally, we recognise that increasing pressure on available marine space is creating tensions between some parts of the fishing fleet and seek views on additional management measures that may be required for the creel, gillnet and longline fisheries. These measures will enable Scotland to deliver on the high-level goals we've jointly agreed with other UK administrations within the UK Joint Fisheries Statement and Fisheries Framework. This approach is a practical demonstration of how this government aims to manage fisheries in the future, working in partnership to agree common goals, with the details of the implementation left to our administration to take forward, given our own unique circumstances, thus avoiding an ill-fitting, one-size-fits-all, single UK fisheries policy. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is committed to being a world leader in fisheries management. We take our role as guardian of Scotland's natural marine environment seriously. The future catching policy will build on our current approach, signalling a step change in the way in which unsustainable fishing practices are tackled. We hope to share learning with our UK and international fisheries partners, demonstrating leadership and supporting others to deliver the right outcomes for our shared fish stocks, our fishing industries and our local communities. To be clear, for both the future catching policy and remote electronic monitoring, all rules and regulations will be applied on a level playing field basis to Scottish vessels and non-Scottish vessels fishing in Scottish waters. Remote electronic monitoring, or REM as it's usually known, adds a crucial layer to the future catching policy and is fundamental to the success of our wider strategy, ensuring that we're fishing sustainably and also delivering accountability and confidence. This morning, I published a consultation on the implementation of remote electronic monitoring to key parts of the fishing fleet. There's no doubt that Scotland's fishers produce a high-quality product that many of us enjoy, but we have to have the confidence that fish stocks are being fished sustainably and responsibly. Many fishers understand this and have taken positive steps to respond. But given the remote nature of fishing operations, it can often be difficult to demonstrate compliance and to deliver the confidence that we need. Technology can help us, and it's only right that we embrace it. Now, many fishers do recognise this already, and this is substantiated by the rise in uptake of voluntary REM installations on active Scottish scallop dredge boats since COVID restrictions started to ease. Over 80% of our active over 10-metre scallop dredge fleet now carry REM on board, which in this case includes cameras, and this is a significant achievement. The consultation on REM confirms this government's commitment to introduce mandatory REM on board all scallop dredge and large pelagic vessels operating in Scottish waters. Subject to parliamentary time and approval, we aim to have that legislation in place by the end of 2022 to do this. The consultation seeks views on key aspects of implementation and also on appropriate wider deployment to other parts of the fishing fleet. REM will enhance the baseline commitment made in the Bute House Agreement for all fishing vessels to be fitted with vessel tracking equipment by the end of this parliamentary term. REM places an enhanced and independent level of monitoring on board, for example by using cameras, sensors and GPS, so that we can determine the fishing activity taking place. In line with our commitment to proportionality, cameras won't necessarily be needed in every case. REM can be adapted depending on need. This is simple but effective technology that will demonstrate Scotland's leading approach to making best use of cutting-edge management tools. REM will deliver on three main outcomes. Firstly, it will enhance our knowledge of fisheries through the gathering of spatially rich scientific data, allowing for better decision making. Secondly, it will deliver confidence and accountability in fishing practices, demonstrating that fishing activity is sustainable and lawful. And thirdly, it will improve the resilience of existing data collection processes, providing uninterrupted data collection regardless of external factors, including COVID. Presiding Officer, I hope my colleagues from around the Chamber will support the policies that have been outlined here today, and I look forward to hearing their views as we can progress with the development and implementation of our broader fisheries management strategy. I also encourage everyone with an interest to access and respond to the consultations that have been announced today. By publishing a future catching policy for Scotland and our proposals to require remote electronic monitoring by key parts of our fishing fleet, we are demonstrating Scotland's leadership in fisheries management, both here on these islands and internationally. We are cementing our credentials as responsible and sustainable fisheries managers and signalling to all fishing vessels operating in Scottish waters that we can and must do better in order to protect and enhance our fantastic marine environment for now and the future. By doing so, we will help to deliver a sustainable future for our fishers, our seafood industry and our coastal communities too. Thank you.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we will need to move to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question would press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for prior sight of her statement. Recent events have shown us that it is a critical importance not just of energy security, but of food security. And in light of concerns around the socio-economic impact of the Bute House Agreement to Scotland's fishing communities, is the Scottish Government committed to fishing as part of the wider importance of Scotland's food security now and in the future? And how will the SNP Green Coalition restore the trust and confidence of fishermen and coastal communities following the failures that the Cabinet Secretary acknowledged last week in the Rain Committee over the recent botched process of regulation, flawed consultation, lack of evidence and zero financial compensation for fishing communities on the Clyde?
Cabinet Secretary.
In relation to Rachel Hamilton's first point about food security, you're absolutely right, and fishing has an absolutely critical role. Fishing, our seafood industry, is vital in this regard because it's a sustainable source of protein, which we need to ensure we can catch sustainably now and into the future, which is part of the reason of why we've set out the policies and the consultation that we have today. So I just want to provide assurances on that front. And in relation to Clyde Cod and the co-management there in the process, now, as I appeared in front of the Rain Committee last week in relation to that, and had rightly said there that the process was far from ideal, and also apologised for that in that committee session, because that process did not follow the principles of co-management that we seek to achieve and that we have had previously in relation to fisheries and working with our stakeholders. That in relation to Clyde Cod, it has been a really complex issue to balance. And as I committed to in the committee session, I aim to ensure that we learn the lessons from how that closure has been managed going forward into the future. But I would say in terms of the policies that I set out today that we have before us in front of the Parliament, these have been developed closely with our stakeholders. But of course, we want to hear views on that, which is why we're launching the consultation. But we are fully committed to a co-management process going forward.
And Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement. Presiding Officer, it's vital that our future catching policy is future-proof and is led by the best, robust scientific evidence to deliver sustainability. The Scottish Government's recent shambolic handling of the Clyde Cod closure shows there is a long way to go, and there remains a gulf between the Cabinet Secretary's rhetoric and the reality when it comes to the implementation of policy. Well, I welcome the two consultations published today. I hope they will ultimately lead to the maximum rollout of remote electronic monitoring, and also there isn't effectively the deregulation of discarding. But can the Cabinet Secretary give an assurance that the actions that come from these consultations will ultimately be governed by a clear commitment by government to fishing quotas staying within robust scientific advice for maximum sustainable yields? And will we also see a significant change in the long term in how quota is allocated to fishing methods that widen the socio-economic benefit and minimise the environmental impact?
Cabinet Secretary.
In relation to the member's first point about REM and the potential that could lead to deregulation, I mean, that's absolutely not where we want to be. And in terms of the future catching policy that we've set out for consultation today, again, that's been developed with our stakeholders because we very much support the principles behind the landing obligation, you know, in relation to reducing waste, improving accountability and safeguarding sustainability. And what we're trying to do with our future catching policy and what REM will really help supplement and help us to deliver the accountability for that is really to ensure that we have a policy that works. And that's what we are committed to here and why we're looking at that and trying to develop a policy that works for the mixed fisheries and the way that our fisheries operate in Scottish waters and in recognition of that. Now, I think the member had also raised a couple of points on quota, and I would say that our general approach for the allocation of quota was set out in our future of fisheries management body of work, which was also developed after public engagement. And within that, there was widespread support to continue with a fixed quota allocation system. And the Scottish Government has committed to its continued use for part of our quota. Where we have stated that we will act differently is in relation to the additional quota that Scotland receives as a result of EU exit. And the distribution of this additional quota for 2023 onwards is going to be the subject of a forthcoming consultation.
Emma Harper to be followed by Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary did mention mixed fisheries in her statement, and I know that the Firth of Clyde and the Clyde catchment area is really, really important on the West Coast. I've been contacted by constituents about the decision to include creel fishers in the seasonal closure of cod fishing between the 14th of February and the 30th of April. And I understand that this seasonal closure has been long-standing as a measure to protect the fish stocks. But can the Cabinet Secretary ensure that the Scottish Government will work closely with creel fishers to ensure that they are able to plan for any potential future business interruption?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, absolutely. As I've said in previous responses, we are absolutely committed to that co-management approach. I understand, again, the concerns that have been raised by the member and that were also raised during the committee session the previous week. Of course, there were specific reasons why we no longer could permit creeling within the Clyde cod box closure, which have been the reasons for that have been outlined previously. But again, co-management is at the heart of what we're trying to deliver here. It's been at the heart of us developing these policies that we've put out for consultation today, and will continue to be key going forward.
Finlay Carson, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Cabinet Secretary, I'm sure much thought went into producing this future catching policy to deflect current EU policies as a result of the SNP's misguided desire to blindly align with the EU's disastrous CFP at the expense of Scottish fishers. Isn't this a missed opportunity to genuinely co-design a much better system suitable for Scottish circumstances rather than tinkering around the edge with the EU's failed landing obligation? And very concerningly, there are multiple mentions of spatial restrictions in the statement, but not enough about spatial pressures. What did the Scottish Government plan to do to address spatial pressures between fishing and offshore wind, which, unless unresolved, will cause even greater pressure between fleet sectors in the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would just like to point out to the member that the approach that we're setting out today in our future catching policy is world leading. Again, we completely support the principles that are behind the landing obligation, and what we're setting out today, and I don't know if the members had a chance to read the consultation document or go through it in detail, is something that is exactly tailored to our industry in Scotland and will deliver on the principles and the intended outcomes of the landing obligation, and do it in a way that works for our industry and recognises the nature of the fisheries that we have here. Now, the member also raised a point about offshore renewables and fisheries. Now, we're aware that there are a number of conflicts there, and there are some specific issues. For example, we know that electricity cabling is a key issue for the fishing sector, and we're seeking to facilitate early engagement with the fishing sector on these matters and to guide developers within that. Now, a sectoral marine plan for offshore grid is going to be undertaken by Marine Scotland to plan for the required network infrastructure, including cable corridors on the seabed and cable landing points requirements for offshore grid, and commercial fisheries will be included in that planning process. And Marine Scotland are also continuing to prioritise and address some of the research gaps that we know are there, including electromagnetic fields, through the Scottish Marine Energy Research Programme. And we're also in the process of setting up a monitoring group that will consider EMF.
Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what the Scottish Government anticipates will be the long-term impact of its fisheries management policies and conservation measures on Scotland's fisheries, and whether the introduction of more no-take zones like the one in Arran's Lamlash Bay will form part of these conservation measures?
Cabinet Secretary.
The fishing industry is a major beneficiary of the natural capital that our seas provide, so it is, of course, vital that we manage that resource carefully for now and as well as for future generations. Now, assessments have shown that action is needed for us to achieve good environmental status, and that's why we've committed to developing the remaining fisheries management measures for marine protected areas and key coastal biodiversity locations outside of these sites by 2024. And in addition to that, we've also committed to designating at least 10% of Scotland's seas as highly protected marine areas by 2026. So that will actually go beyond what we see in no-take zones, because it will exclude all extractive, destructive and depositional activities, and that's not just fisheries.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's concerning that the consultation appears to suggest that only marketable bycatch will be landed. This does nothing to cut the waste of dumping dead fish back into the sea, and it could also encourage catching of marketable fish for which there is no quota. Can I urge the Cabinet Secretary to ensure that all bycatch is landed, that uses such as farmed fish food are developed for otherwise unmarketable fish to cut waste? And will she also take steps to ensure that lucrative species with no quota are not targeted, which would put stocks in danger?
Cabinet Secretary.
Again, a key part of what we're hoping to achieve with the future catching policy is that everything caught is accounted for. So I just want to assure the member on that point. And in relation to the other points that she's raised as well, that's exactly why we're having this consultation, and it's to make sure that we get this policy right, and that's absolutely what we want to achieve. So I would encourage the member and our constituents to fill in this consultation and to make their views known on these specific issues.
Karen Adam to be followed by Beatrice Wisher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, how does what we're doing on Discord ban compare with the EU approach, and also what is happening elsewhere in the UK?
Cabinet Secretary.
The landing obligation, or the discard ban, is part of retained EU law, and the current rules around discarding are consistent with the EU and the rest of the UK. So our commitment, as I've outlined in some of my previous responses today, to tackling discarding isn't going to change. But we do know that there are improvements we can make to the implementation of the landing obligation that will make the rules around discarding more effective. And what we're hoping to achieve through the future catching policy is really to improve on those current rules while staying true to the principles of the landing obligation. So what's really key to that, though, is tackling unwanted catch, and that's helping fishers to avoid catching fish and other species that they don't want to catch in the first place. And we really want to ensure that we share the learning through our future catching policy with our partners in the EU and the rest of the UK, so that we can all improve outcomes for our shared fish stocks.
Beatrice Wisher to be followed by Jenny Minto.
It's not only the Scottish Government and environmental groups who want to see sustainable fisheries management. Fishermen whose livelihoods depend on healthy seas and thriving stocks want this too. In a crowded marine environment, Scottish vessels are being squeezed further with practices like gillnet fishing, which often add to marine litter, thereby exacerbating biodiversity loss. We've all seen images of seals and seabirds entangled in discarded fishing gear. Any changes need to be based in fact, and fishermen must have confidence that scientific evidence is accurate and up to date. How will the Scottish Government ensure just that, that the evidence they are using is accurate and up to date?
Cabinet Secretary.
We want to ensure that by obviously I've outlined today that our commitment to that co-management process and listening to our stakeholders, and that's very much what we want to achieve. And in relation to the first point that the member raised about the crowded marine environment and some of the conflicts that we can encounter there, and I know some of the matters that Beatrice Wishart has just raised, she's also corresponded to me about, and I want to just touch on one of those specifically, which is raised in the consultation document, which is about gill nets and long lines, because we know that there are issues here. And what is essential, though, is that we work together to arrive at the solutions to allow legitimate fishing operations to work alongside each other. So that's why, within the consultation document itself, we posed a series of questions to really try and explore some of the options that might be there. And we would hope to develop those into firm proposals following the consultation and, of course, working closely with our stakeholders too. Now, we acknowledge that, of course, there can be issues with finding space in the shared marine environment, and we would expect all fishers to operate within the law and to do that in a safe and responsible way.
Thank you. Jenny Minto, to be followed by Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Cabinet Secretary has said, there is a need to balance environmental, economic and social interests in terms of fishing. How will this policy seek to do this, and in particular reassure coastal communities that fishing is valued and has a viable future in spite of all the impacts of Brexit?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would first of all just really want to offer that assurance, because as our fisheries management strategy outlines, fisheries management can be very complex, and our decision making will always need to take account of a variety of different factors. And as we're taking forward the individual policies and actions within the strategy, we're seeking to use co-management to inform their development, and as part of our decision making, we'll be taking account of the various economic, social and environmental factors. And I think it's important to remember here is that there is no one-size-fits-all approach, because these factors depend on what we're trying to achieve and the specific policy that we're looking to deliver to. Now, we know that the impacts of Brexit are being felt right across Scotland, and that the fishing industry has been hit particularly hard in relation to trade. And the Scottish Government is supporting the seafood sector through the Marine Fund Scotland. And I just want to make clear that within that, in the Marine Fund, around £13 million has been awarded to date across a range of different projects, which include supporting our young fishers to enter the sea fisheries industry, vessel refurbishment, as well as helping them to purchase new and more sustainable fishing gear. And that's in addition to the £40 million under the European Maritime and Fisheries Fund that we provided to support an innovative and competitive sector, which also helped to build that vital capacity too.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess, to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her advanced side of her statement? I welcome the consultations published today and the commitment to deliver a fisheries management strategy which is prioritised around the environment, recognising the scale of change needed. Since big changes are required, it's more important than ever to take a genuine co-management approach, which includes all stakeholder groups when developing policy to deliver fisheries for the future. I particularly welcome the commitment to roll out remote electronic monitoring across the Scottish fleet, a measure for which the Scottish Greens have been calling for some time. The consultation indicates a staged approach to the development of REM on different fleet segments. We must prioritise the segments with the highest risk of wildlife bycatch and the greatest need to change gear, vessels and practices, as a just transition requires sufficient time and support to make those changes. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an indication of timings for the rollout of REM across the different fleets, including the demersal fleet, to provide assurance that the majority of fishers will be given the tools they need to play
Cabinet
an even
Secretary,
greater
Cabinet
role
Secretary,
as stewards
Cabinet
of the
Secretary,
sea and by the end of this parliamentary
Cabinet
session?
Secretary.
We want to make sure that as we deliver this policy, well, as we develop it and we deliver it, that we do it in a way that works and that we get it right, because installing REM is a huge undertaking. So that is exactly why we've proposed the approach that's been set out in the consultation in relation to the member's point on prioritising fleet segments. And that's why we focused initially on the pelagic sector as well as the scallop dredge fleet segment too. Now, we know that for the scallop dredge fleet, 80% of those over 10 metres already have REM installed. So there are some REM, in a sense, could be more easily installed on the rest of that fleet, but we know that will be more of a challenge for others where that technology hasn't been used or brought forward within the fleet itself. So that's why we've set out the approach that we've had, and we've asked within the consultation about rolling that out to further fleet segments. But we do think this is absolutely critical in helping us to achieve the objectives of our future catching policy as well. But I think that we've tried to take that proportionate approach and ensure that when we deliver this policy, we're doing it in a way that works and that, to ensure that we get it right.
Thank you. Just a gentle reminder that when I call somebody to speak, it's an invitation for them to speak and for the person that was speaking to stop speaking. I now call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Edward Mayne.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary say how Scotland's catching policy will help deliver the objectives we are now required to work towards in the Fisheries Act of 2020?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Fisheries Act and the Joint Fisheries Statement set the common high-level goals on fisheries management, which the future catching policy provides the details on how we will deliver that by implementing more sustainable fishing gears to reduce bycatch, as well as minimising catches of sensitive species and using monitoring tools in order to ensure that vessels in Scottish waters fish to the highest possible standards. But specific to the Fisheries Act 2020, the future catching policy will ensure that all management measures are developed in collaboration with the latest scientific evidence, with the health of fish stocks in mind, and ensuring a sustainable future for Scottish fisheries and honouring the sustainability, precautionary and scientific evidence objectives. And with the commitment to level playing field for all measures in the future catching policy, that means that we'll also be delivering on the equal access and national benefit objectives. And with a suite of technical and spatial measures, the future catching policy will ultimately aim to be world-leading in the way that we address issues with bycatch, in line with the Fisheries Act, a bycatch ecosystem and climate change objectives too.
And I call Edward Mountain, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In 2015, the then Cabinet Secretary said that 21st century fisheries management needs 21st century food tools. In 2016, your government promised new legislation to address this. Unfortunately, nothing's happened since. Cabinet Secretary, we clearly need an indoor fisheries bill that both Richard Lockhead and Fergus Ewing promised before they were sacked. Will you deliver where they failed?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm sorry, I missed parts of the first part of the member's comments there. But I mean, what we're looking to achieve here through setting out the policies that are out to consultation today and that we'll be delivering by legislation later this year is truly world leading. So I would just want to emphasise that to the member. We set out our future fisheries management strategy in 2020. We set out the 12 actions as a result of that, and we'll also be publishing our delivery plan. But the future catching policy, the consultation we've set out on that today, and what we've set out on REM really drives that strategy forward and, again, makes us world leaders in this field.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes this item of business. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.